Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Nice to have you with us today. And for our listeners to one of our sister stations, WBAI in New York, it's off the air again today. And they're having electrical problems in the Empire State Building in their main room, and they will let us know when it's fixed. But if you've taken down the number, as I've suggested many times, and you're listening over the telephone or over PRN.FM, over the Internet, today we're going to have Gerald Celante on. I'm going to spend extra time with Gerald, at least a half hour, because he is the leading trends expert in America. And we're going to look at all the different trends that are coming at us. And when you consider that we have a perfect storm, we have more people sick right now in America than ever before in our history. More diabetes, approaching 100 million between actual diagnosed diabetes and pre-diabetes are going to become it, obesity and being overweight, heart disease, depression, anxiety, insomnia, and Alzheimer's, Parkinson's. We're a mess. That's one problem. This past year, we suffered from more than 12,000 unique weather experiences. The worst flooding in Florida history, the worst flooding in Texas history, the worst fires in California history, the worst fires in Montana history, the worst fires in Oregon and Washington State. We had the worst flooding at the beginning of 2017 than any time in Louisiana history. So those are just some, and yet we're not prepared going forward. We should be. We'll talk with Gerald about that. So we have environmental crisis, we have monetary crisis, more people are unemployed, and yet they're being discounted, meaning they're taken off the roll so nobody knows they're invisible. So we're not counting the numbers. We're living with the myth that we're booming and prosperous. Some people are, but a lot of people are not. So we have an economic issue with a fiat currency that sooner or later, that bubble's going to burst. I believe it'll burst within the next 2 to 3 years. That means that whatever you have now valued at the dollar will be less a lot, worth a lot less. So we're going to talk about all this with Gerald, and not even including the body politic. But first we go to health and healing. From Washington University School of Medicine comes a study about how lack of sleep, that's an epidemic in America, boosts the levels of Alzheimer's proteins. Now, let's just ask a basic question. We all make resolutions, we just don't keep them. And there's a relatively painless way to do this. Catch a few more nights of quality sleep. A third of American adults don't get enough sleep. And chronic poor sleep has been linked to cognitive decline in a new study from Washington University School of Medicine in St. Louis says that as a wakeful brain churns away through the night, it produces more of the Alzheimer's protein amyloid beta than its waste disposal system can handle. And levels of the protein rise, potentially setting off a sequence of changes to the brain that can end with dementia. Quote, this study is the clearest demonstration in humans that sleep disruption leads to an increased risk of Alzheimer's disease through an amyloid beta mechanism. That's according to Dr. Randall Bateman, MD, who heads that department as Distinguished Professor of Neurology. So in lay language, and this was published in the Annals of Neurology, you're looking at more than 5 million diagnosed with Alzheimer's. I'm suggesting there's 20 million with prediagnosis, meaning they don't have Alzheimer's officially diagnosed, but they're on their way to getting there. And in the next 5 years, they will have that diagnosis. Overwhelming our medical system. When you have 20 million people suffering from Alzheimer's, they can't take care of themselves. Even last night, I was counseling late at night a friend of mine whose mother has Alzheimer's, And now this person is very ill, has chronic infections, and in fact went to the emergency room last night, and I gave him a whole protocol what to do. And why? Because they're stressed. They're not getting sleep. They're running over to their mothers all the time. They don't want to put their mother in a home. And yet the mother is extremely resistant, as most people with Alzheimer's would be, to trying anything. As a result, she has to kind of sneak it into smoothies and shakes, the protocol. But getting the mother up to exercise, getting those muscles working, getting the kind of therapies can make a difference? No, it doesn't work in most of the cases. So as a result, the child in their 40s or 50s is now watching the mother or father in their 70s or 80s deteriorate. That's an enormously stressful thing because you're looking at the end of a life. And the fear of that end of life, the fear of loss, it's with you every day. And that creates stress hormones, and the stress hormones then impact your body. Well, now it's saying if you're not getting that good night's sleep, automatically your body, your brain is creating more of those amyloid plaques. And we have tens of millions of Americans who are not getting a good night's sleep for a number of reasons. So always get a good night's sleep. That's very important. Help protect against Alzheimer's. Then there's new guidelines from the Mayo Clinic where we should be exercising to improve our memory and thinking. That's correct. For patients with mild cognitive impairment, this is people who can function. They may still be working, but they're suffering from mild impairment means you forget what you just talked about, who you just spoke with. You forget names of people you've known, maybe your first or last name, a title of a book, a movie you've just seen. What did you eat for breakfast this morning? I don't remember. But they can have a conversation with you on other topics. Long-term memory seems fine. And they can come in and out of this. You see, with all mental conditions, you must understand that it's tricky. It looks like a person's getting worse, and then suddenly they get better. Or at least they stop getting worse. And you think, oh, that's good. They're making improvements. No, they've just slowed down. And then they get worse again. And so that is common. You got to really be working with a special protocol to help them. So what this is saying is this, that for patients with mild cognitive impairment, you've got to exercise rather than medication. The medication will do nothing for you. It doesn't reverse or slow down any form of brain impairment. That's all a myth. So the Mayo Clinic is saying that there's new guidelines for doctors to suggest a minimum of recommending twice a week exercise to people with mild cognitive impairment to improve memory and thinking. And the recommendation is part of an updated guideline for mild cognitive impairment published in the current issue of Neurology. Quote, regular physical exercise has long been shown to have heart-healthy benefits, and now we can say exercise also may improve memory for people with mild cognitive impairment. Good. So, and keep in mind that mild cognitive impairment is an intermediate stage between the expected cognitive decline of normal aging and the more serious decline of dementia. And symptoms can involve problems with your memory, language, thinking, judgment. Those are all adversely affected. And generally, these changes aren't severe enough to significantly interfere with day-to-day life and usual activities. However, mild cognitive impairment may increase the risk of later progressing to dementia caused by Alzheimer's disease. So just get out 5 days a week, 6 days a week. Also, a lot of people this time of year, because of colds or flu, because of weakened immune systems, they're taking antibiotics. Big mistake. Antibiotics are specific, like for gram-negative bacteria. They have nothing in the world to do with viruses. It is one of the most common medical errors. Tens of millions of prescriptions are written each year for antibiotics for cold or flu. All that does is it destroys whatever good bacteria you have in your system, the biome, and then allows harmful bacteria or antibiotic-resistant bacteria to take their place, which makes it a double negative. So what do we do? I would suggest the following. So please write this down. In fact, I suggested this last night to my friend who was so sick, and all they were going to give her was antibiotics. First, start with olive leaf extract. Why? Because extensive studies have shown that the Mediterranean diet has proven ability to lower the risk of potentially life-threatening conditions like cancer and heart disease and diabetes and obesity. And researchers believe that olive oil and olive leaf extract play a major role in conferring these benefits. They do. That's thanks to a natural plant compound, and that compound in the olive is called oleuropein. O-L-E-U-R-O-P-E-I-N. Now, in terms of the olive leaf extract, it's made from olive leaves and offers a richer source of this particular compound, which can be a potent ally against chronic diseases, and is extremely good against viruses and bacteria. Olive leaf is just the olive leaf, and you can extract the chemicals from that. Well, you can't, but it's done for you, and that can lower the LDL cholesterol, it can lower triglycerides, it promotes cardiovascular health, it lowers the viral load in the body, and also it reduces the stickiness of blood platelets, thereby directly preventing the formation of arterial plaques and cutting the risk of a heart attack or stroke. And in the 1800s, crushed olive leaves were served in drinks to lower fevers and brewed into teas to treat malaria. Well, 200 years later, studies are confirming this chemical's powerful antiviral, antifungal, and antibacterial effect. Not only does this potent polyphenol stop the replication of viruses, but it destroys Candida albicans fungus and E. coli bacteria as well. And researchers say that olive leaf extract can combat both influenza and shingles, not to mention the common cold. In fact, a study conducted at New York University School of Medicine, researchers found that treatment with olive leaf extract reversed many changes associated with HIV infection, which is a truly promising finding. And it also helps with different forms of dementia, and it protects you against cognitive decline as well as Alzheimer's disease. And so by as much as 55% in one study. And also, olive leaf extract is effective in preventing the neurofibrillary bundles of what are called hyperphosphorylated proteins, or tau tangles, that's TAU, which affects the brains of patients with Alzheimer's disease. So our herb of the day, or our nutrient of the day, is olive leaf. It can lower blood sugar in diabetics, by the way. It's very good on that. And it reduces pressure in the heart's left ventricle and improving flow to coronary blood vessels. So it significantly can drop blood pressure. And that was published in Phytomedicine. So that would be the number one I would put ingredient in a home medicine cabinet. Second ingredient would be wild oregano oil. You should not just take it by putting it in your mouth. It's a little too strong. You can put it in a juice. And the juice that would be best for a cold or the flu would be 2 ounces of ginger juice, 2 ounces of lemon, and 2 ounces of apple cider vinegar. With that, you have 8 ounces of aloe vera juice. Then put in another 5 to 6 ounces of beet and green apple juice. Then you add your tinctures, 20 drops of wild oregano oil. That's out of a single dropper. So wild oregano has a broad spectrum of antibacterial and antiviral relief. Then you add into that drink, you can have capsule open up or liquid, the probiotics, between 5 to 15 billion per drink. You might have 2 or 3 drinks throughout the day. And then you should have some liquid garlic, generally 1 teaspoon full 3 times a day. And in a salad have, or in some brown rice, have some raw onion, not cooked, sweet onion, Vidalia 1040, Maui onion, any of those. And then also have Paldiarco, Paldiarco, D-A-R-C-U. And Paldiarco is extremely good at 100 milligrams, Echinacea 100 milligrams, Astragalus 100 milligrams. 3 separate things. Well, actually 4. Paldiarco, P-A-R-D-O-K-U, I think it is. Astragalus, Echinacea, all right, and then bee propolis. 1 teaspoon of bee propolis and 1 teaspoon of Manuka honey. Now, you can put all that at the same time into your health smoothie that I just gave you the ingredients for. It'll be a little strong, but it's extremely powerful. And we should have those ingredients at all times in our homes. Now, you do that 3 times a day, and you'll find how potent you are. When I take my drink in the morning before I work out, I'm using a lot of apple cider vinegar and lemon juice and beet juice, and that alkalizes the body also. So those are things that can make a difference. Also, from Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health, published in the European Respiratory Journal, is an article that found protective effects of tomatoes and other high antioxidant fruits. After all, tomato is a fruit, against the decline in lung function that can occur during aging. Quote, in the present study, we sought to investigate whether a higher intake of dietary sources, and this was in the European adult, middle-aged group of people, could attenuate aging-related lung function over a 10-year period. And they found that it did. So quite simply, by having apples, tomatoes, grapes, rich sources of vitamin C, bananas are good, green tea, it's all associated with a decline in forced vital capacity, or FVC. That's another measure for lung function. Quite simply, you're going to have stronger lungs, healthier lungs, the more tomatoes, the more apples, and the more vitamin C that you take. Now, consider how many people one time smoke but don't smoke any longer. That's restorative. Also, from Harvard School of Public Health, higher dietary fiber intake in young women can reduce breast cancer risk. This is very important because women who eat more high-fiber foods, I'm suggesting 30 to 50 grams a day, during adolescence and young adulthood, especially lots of fruits and vegetables, and especially top of that list would be blueberries and pomegranates, can have significantly lower breast cancer risk than those who eat less dietary fiber when young. And that was published in the journal Pediatrics. Quote from the study, previous studies of fiber intake and breast cancer have almost all been non-significant, and none of them examined diet during adolescence or early adulthood, a period when breast cancer risk factors appear to be particularly important. This work on the role of nutrition in early life and breast cancer incidence suggests one of the very few potentially modifiable risk factors for premenopausal breast cancer. They looked at 90,000 women who were nurses and over a long period of time, and they found more fiber, less breast cancer. And finally, cacao, which is chocolate, and what's important in that is the flavanols, may use your gut microbiota pathway to ease metabolic syndrome review. This was in the Journal of Nutritional Biochemistry. And so what in lay language it means is when you consume chocolate, healthy chocolate, at high 60% or higher, the flavanols react with your gut bacteria as a way of preventing metabolic syndrome or easing the conditions of those, like diabetes. This was published in the Journal of Nutritional Biochemistry. So 2 ounces a day of chocolate could help you if you have heart disease or you have diabetes. And one last thing from the Max Rubner Institute in Germany. A lifelong exposure to dietary isoflavones reduces the risk of obesity. And a new study on diet nutrition disorders showed this. So where do you get these? Where do you get these isoflavones? Organic soy. That's your best place to get them. And one last one, because it's so important. This is from Texas A&M University. Research suggests prenatal carnitine, C-A-R-N-I-T-I-N-E, carnitine, could help prevent autism. This is an article appearing in the Cell Reports journal. It reveals the findings of researchers at Texas A&M of a potential role of carnitine as a prenatal supplement to protect against a variety of autism in unborn children. Now, you can get a vegan form of carnitine. That's what I take. It comes in a little clear capsule, or the non-vegan carnitine. And it's manufactured in the body from the amino acid lysine. And research has shown that inherited mutations in the gene TMLHE required for carnitine synthesis are associated with development of autism spectrum disorders. Yet the mechanism supporting the relationship has not yet been established. So my suggestion, all pregnant women, take 500 milligrams a day of L-carnitine if you have an intended pregnancy. On our next program, we'll go into the scientific defense of Brussels sprouts and other cruciferous vegetables. I'm Gary Null, and we're going to take a brief break and come right back. Please stay with us.
We got it together, didn't we? We've definitely got our thing together, don't we? Isn't that nice? I mean, really, when you really sit and think about it, isn't it really, really nice? I can easily feel myself slipping more and more waves.
I'd like to welcome all of you. I'm Gary Null. On Monday, I will have a show at noon talking about my projections for 2018 and all the different things that were able to be maintained and improved or changed in 2017. So my year in perspective and my year ahead will be this coming Monday. But right now, before we go to our guests, let's go over and say hello to Elizabeth. Hi, Elizabeth.
Hi, Gary. Here's a good question. We've had a lot of them coming in from Meredith. She's 35 years old, and she describes a bit about her life and things. She says she was born and raised in the Midwest, and then she came to New York after college and has worked her way up. But just after Christmas, she became quite depressed because she saw that her generation felt it was so superficial. They spend all their time on social media. She thinks they're addicted to it. When she asks if people want to go to see the Christmas tree or do other things in New York. They are replying to her that they just want to see her online. Some of her friends are going into chat rooms when they'd all be chatting at the same time, but she thinks these are not real interactions. She's listened to your show for the last 5 years. She said it keeps her grounded and sane. And she was mentioning that she feels her time in New York is at an end because she can't afford to be here. She doesn't have rich parents, but has stayed as she rationalizes that it has all its culture, all the culture at her fingertips, but she's really done all of that multiple times and is bored with the city, which she thinks is too expensive and her generation just too shallow. She's heard you mention the idea of intentional communities, and she'd like you to please describe what you mean in greater depth.
Okay, well, she's raised several points there. Let's try to take them on. For all of us who live in New York or the immediate area, one of the reasons we do so is because it's important for career opportunities. There's also the finest culture that I could find in the world. I've been to other capitals, Paris and London and Rio, but it's, nothing's like New York. Also, I've never found a people as unique as New Yorkers. They're very honest. They'll tell you what they feel, what they think, whether you like it or not. And there's the ability to be as creative as you choose to be. Every second of every day, someone in New York is getting up on their feet creatively and having the support system of a city that says, yes, if you can be that good, we'll support you. I've not found that anywhere else in America. And yet many other places have wonderful qualities. But New York has its own vibration. It's a very high-level vibration. How many times have I walked down to, for example, walked down to the Village, gone to the Quad, gone to West Broadway and walked down the streets looking in the shops, going in galleries? It's just a nice way to spend an afternoon. But then one day you realize how many times you've done it. Then you ask other friends who live in Manhattan or boroughs, when was the last time you went to the Empire State Building or the Statue of Liberty or took one of those tour buses or went someplace unique? Or when did you just walk for hours around Soho or Bed-Stuy or any of the other unique neighborhoods? And it's much like the disco scene. To me, the most enjoyable time I ever had in New York was during the 1970s. I love the music. I love the energy of the people, the openness, the ability for people to enjoy their lives. And there was just, it was part of that, what had started in Haight-Ashbury in San Francisco, the Summer of Love, where everything was possible, in Woodstock, the liberation of a young group of people, our young group of people, our baby boomers were young, idealistic, free-thinking, many, not all. And there were places you could go. Taos, New Mexico was wonderful for artists. This is even before Austin became anything of essentialness. Boulder, Colorado was one of those places, but Haight-Ashbury was one of the best. I was out there. I saw it. And then you went to the scenes, New York, New York, Bonds, Infinity, the Underground, and, of course, most famous, Studio 54. We'd have a whole group of us going in there and dancing and enjoying the music and going to dinner and at another place and saying, wow, what a day. And then one day you realize you're not going out dancing because you're now considered an age that you shouldn't be out dancing. It's for a younger generation. And then how many times have you walked by things and taken it for granted? I walk to work. I walk by Lincoln Center. I walk down Broadway. I walk by Madison Square Garden. I walk by places every day that people come from around the world to appreciate. But it's no different. How many times have people who live beside the Eiffel Tower, they don't even look up anymore because every day it's right there. They just see it. You live in London. You walk through an area that you've taken for granted a long time ago. When was the last time you went into Westminster Abbey? So you don't think about it. What we do is the people in our lives we frequently take for granted at a certain point. The environment we live in we take for granted. Not only that, but our own health we take for granted. Well, we've been there and done that. So if you get to a point for this young woman or this woman who called, when you no longer can appreciate a city like New York for its culture, its diversity of thought, its challenging personalities, its ability to be the progenitor of new and wonderful plays and poetry and music and movements and fashion, then it's time to move on. Now, I don't believe you should stay in an environment just because you've always been there. That's like being in a relationship that no longer has vitalism. We all have responsibilities in relationships to see what we can do to revitalize that relationship. Get it back to where it's harmonizing at a higher frequency. It'd be like being around great minds who no longer want to think great or talk great. What's the point of that? Then let's try to find out why they're no longer thinking and speaking the way they once did. So I would suggest that if New York is too expensive, if you're finding that the limitations of living here, because 51% of all the people living in New York City are living at or below the poverty level, that you not simply be a witness to those who are rich enough, including in your generation, to go in and spend at one Upper West Side place that I've walked into. I want to see for myself, the average beer is $50 because it's the local beers and a pig's head sandwich, who would eat such a thing, but it was $80. And the people had, you know, all kinds of beer in front of them, which means they were dropping $500 or $600 in a night and not thinking about it. And maybe you're working hard as you can, and you have to live in an apartment with three other people, or two other people, one other person, and it's a small apartment to begin with. Where's the quality of life for you? You can't afford to go to the very places that make the city at one time wonderful, where the middle class could afford the city and its culture. And how many times can you go to a place and say, okay, it still has that excitement for me? How many times can you go to a museum? I went to a Museum of Natural History this past week, last Saturday. Had a wonderful day, but I realized that's about the 100th time I've been through that exhibit, and it hadn't changed. So we have to at some point stop and say, have I spent too much time in this chapter of my life? Where would I like to go? Now, she mentioned an intentional community. I believe that we need intentional communities all around the United States. We do not have them now. An intentional community is not a co-op. It is not it's not a cult. It's not a compound. It's not a commune. It's where creative minds come together, each maintaining their own individual autonomous self, working on projects that are important and exciting for them, but sharing some things in common, sharing the common environment, the beauty of a place, maybe sharing meals together, and doing things that you yourself would be stressed to do or couldn't do because you wouldn't have all the resources. So there's where we have to start thinking of the we instead of me. What can we do together that honors the best of who we are, and doing things that we may have to master from the beginning? And what we do in our society is we live our whole lives by continuously dragging out every time we can our qualities, our assets. And that means we stop growing. We stop learning. We stop challenging. When you've mastered something, surrender it and master something else. You become a far more interesting person. So I suggest that this woman make a list of everything they want to change and then select one thing only. Just one thing, because that's doable. And if you want to know whether or not you're going to do that one thing, then look at to see the future, just project your constraints. Because most people will never, ever engage in any New Year's resolution or change anything in their life, no matter how bad the environment is, no matter if they're just got flooded in Texas, they're going to stay there. They just had their home vandalized, as a gazillion people did in Florida when they left 7 million people, the largest evacuation of any state in American history for that hurricane, and came home to find not only was the hurricane damaging everything, but the burglars were there to clean out anything of value, and there were no police around because the police were manning traffic lights where there was no power. So what causes someone to stay in the wrong place for too long, including relationships? That's your constraint. And your constraint becomes your future. If you live by constraints, if you live by, then you have no future. All you have is your past. And therefore, you'll walk into that museum for the 1,000th time, but it's lost that excitement. It's lost that high-level vibration. You'll have conversations with people. You know what they're going to say before they say it because they haven't changed their perspectives or their presentations. It's like going to watch a doo-wop song when the guys are being brought out in beds from a nursing home and singing from their nursing home beds. Man, when I see some of those old doo-wop shows now, it's embarrassing. Guys can't even move on stage. And the voices are not what they once were, but people are still there. Why not something new? So you've got to spend more time and energy seeking happiness and avoiding suffering. If you're in an environment or a relationship, if you're in a work or doing something, you've got to constantly make excuses to yourself or others why you continue to suffer with something that's less than optimally beneficial to you. Then you've identified more with your suffering presence than you have with your authentic presence. So select everything in life as if you were starting over. And you can't change anything without risks. And every risk can create a crisis, and every crisis can distort your perception of reality. Don't live through illusions to happiness or well-being, because you're not going to find security in your illusions. And never lose your love and joy and creativity and compassion. And stop holding on to your conditioning. Stop resisting change. That said, then you look and say, okay, I believe that the future for a limited number of people, because there are only a small number of people who would see themselves living in an intentional community, is where you go to a place to live for whatever period of time you choose, because you see that in that environment, there are people who are self-realized, meaning they've been screened so that they're not bringing a basket full of woe. The person that shows up at the door with 3,000 merit badges, all that they are martyrs and suffering, that's not a person you want in. The person that's a whiner, blamer, moaner, and complainer, that too. The ideologue that wants to convince everyone there of whatever their belief is right and everything else wrong, you don't want that person. You want more dynamic people or subtle people who are just comfortable in their own lives and they're able to be around you without trying to change you. And those are the people. So you go through a screening process. That's the single most important part of it. Then you get a property, generally a white elephant, something that at one time was wonderful, but then lost that ability to be wonderful and had to be given up, and someone else can take it over and either take it over together, but I don't recommend that. I'm completely against people collectively pulling their money and investing in a property because it never works. One person, the person that's got the financial resources, they buy the property. Everyone else contributes to their own projects, so if something goes wrong, they can go on and the property stays. If you have conflicts in people, especially in relationships, when that goes south, which it could, then the whole project comes to an end. Other people say, hey, you know, why can't you get it together? Well, we can't, and so we're going to have to sell the whole place. So you've got to have financial stability. That means you have to have an ethical capitalist, someone who is conscious of the power of money to do good and not for greed. And they can see things built, hydroponic houses, artisans' villages, that can serve a larger need, where other people wouldn't have the money to do that on their own, can now have the skills and can do that and then share their skills with the world by streaming out over video. Let's say you're a glassblower, but you don't have the money to succeed in New York. It's too expensive. And you don't have the money to go buy a place, but if you were artist who were glassblower, you would then, in your little studio, you would put video cameras and do webinars every week. So ever all over the world, people wanted to go, know glassblowing, could come and watch it, and you could earn an income, be doing your craft. But when you're finished, you can go sit at a table and have someone who's a real chef make food, so you're just not hoveling over a cold bowl of brown rice with some, maybe some olive oil on it. You'd have a gourmet meal. That's an intended community. And they are going to be coming into the fore. And then when they do happen and people see what a wonderful life it is, then every day is a new experience. Because you're working with other people in an environment that make it interesting. So there's not the loneliness of the person who's suffering to master something or to survive on their own. And I see that happening this year. Okay, we're out of time. Thank you for that. Listen, immediately go over and say hello to our guest standing by on the phone, Gerald Salante.
Hey,
and Gerald. Gary. Hi, Gerald. Gerald, everyone in this audience knows you and hopefully listens to your program on Progressive Radio Network every week and reads the Trends Journal. So what I want to do, Gerald, I want to ask you, I'm just going to give you some questions and let you run with it, all right?
Okay.
You're the person who's looking at the trends for 2018, and the trends that I believe that we should know more about is making sure that Saudi Arabia and Israel and this current administration of superhawks don't allow a war against Iran. That's one. And also the U.S. alignment with Israel making Jerusalem the capital, but alienating so much of the world. That's number two. And what is this going to do to the oil market? And what would be domestic repercussions from it? And then finally, I want you to take a look at where our economies stand as far as slow deflation over the next 2 to 3 years. The power of the dollar now that it's going to be challenged over the next 2 to 3 years by Russia and China and other Southeast supported countries that they're in alignment with, where they're building relationships based upon building other people's economy and putting in the new Silk Road. And we're just putting military bases around the world and regime change. So sooner or later, China and Russia will have a more dominant part in the currency than the United States. What will that do and the likely outcome to the dollar and all those investments against the dollar? You got plenty to address there. The form is yours.
On Saudi Arabia, we've been writing about this in the Trends Journal now for the last two issues, and it's one of our top trends for 2018, and it's stock market dive and mass murder. And what we're saying is that the markets are going to be affected by the mass murder that's going to be created in the Middle East with this Saudi prince. And you know how he became a prince. A princess kissed a frog, and the frog became a prince. I mean, what kind of prince? Who saved this junk for somebody else? You know, this is a gang that was created in 1932, and they're blowing out this baloney that he's getting rid of corruption. And what corruption? This is the guy that just bought that Da Vinci painting for almost $500 million, $500 million. He bought a $500 million yacht, and now he just bought the Louis the 14th Chateau for $400 million. So it has nothing to do with corruption. It has to do with a 30-year-old guy that's out of his mind when he started the Yemen war that the United States never talks about. But the media doesn't, but it's the United States supports the war. Between Obama and Trump, it's reported that they sold the Saudis over $400 billion worth of weapons. So Yemen is a mess. It has a cholera of a million people. 8.5 million people are suffering from starvation. And the Saudis, the United States, is providing the air refueling for the bombing, the weapons to bomb, and the so-called intelligence, which, of course, you know, when you look at American intelligence and the CIA, it's an oxymoron. There is no intelligence. It's just mass murder. So going back to what you said about Israel, the United States, and Israel, the United States, and Saudi Arabia against Iran. That was going on when he did the palace purge, the prince, and you had the prime minister of Lebanon announcing from Saudi Arabia that he was resigning his post as prime minister of Lebanon. He's also, the prime minister, Haradi, is also a Sunni. And they made a deal in Lebanon between the Shia, the Sunnis, and the non-secular groups to form a government. So now he went and broke that deal, but the deal goes deeper than that because his father, Haradi's father, is a big construction magnet in Saudi Arabia. And Saudi Arabia right now is in a recession because of oil prices. They need oil at $100 a barrel. It's been around, you know, since 2014 when it fell in June to just recently, it fluctuated between around $30 to $60 a barrel. Now it's a little bit over. But so they have a crisis going on over there. When all else fails, they take you to war. The Saudis also lost in their trying to overthrow, along with the United States, Syria. And now Israel, Netanyahu, the prime minister, is telling the Iranians who were invited into Syria that he will not tolerate the Iranians from staying in Syria. Who is he to say this? Oh, they stole the Golan Heights, too. I don't know if God gave him that one, and, you know, because God was a real estate agent, according to Netanyahu and the Zionists, and the Bible was a land deed. And the world just began, you know, only a couple of thousand years ago. So forget that 13-million-year-old skull that was found recently. That doesn't count. So now what the United States is doing, go back to Trump, go back to the campaign trail. He kept going after Iran. We, you know, we gave him $100 billion. You didn't give him any money at all. That was their money, and you stole it when they threw out the Shah back in the 70s, 79. But and his son-in-law, Kushner, Jared Kushner, they support the settlements, their foundation. And we have an ambassador that's an Orthodox Jew that's telling, after you mentioned about Jerusalem and Trump saying that that's the capital, he was just quoted 2 days ago as saying that the Palestinians are overreacting from it. And when Netanyahu comes to America, one time he stayed in Jared Kushner's bedroom at his parents' house. It's a takeover in front of our eyes. If the United States goes to war against Iran, this will be the beginning of World War III. These are the Persians. They're not going anywhere. So that's what we're concerned about. And when that happens, you're going to see the markets crash. On to the dollar. The dollar's going, it's down now. Gold has broke over $1,300 an ounce because of the weakness of the dollar. However, we believe the dollar is going to find initial strength short term because of the Trump plan allowing the big corporations, the multinationals, to bring back the money. What they're going to do with that money, now when they're taking money out of these countries, tens of trillions of dollars, that means it's going to drive down their currencies temporarily because the money's being cashed back into dollars. That money, going back again, only by the facts. When they did this in 2004 under Bush, when he allowed the multinationals to do these tax breaks, where we the little people have to pay every stinking penny that we owe, it drove up the markets because it went into stock buybacks. It's not going into capital improvements. It has not gone into capital improvements. The corporations are making a lot of money already. The only reason the markets keep going up is because of stock buybacks and merger and acquisition activity because of all the cheap dough. So temporarily, it'll drive the dollar up. Long term, China, Russia, Venezuela, China's the biggest importer of oil in the world. They don't want to pay it in petrodollars anymore. That was the deal made by Nixon back in the 1970s to the Saudi gang. Listen, we'll protect you, the gang, but you got to sell all oil in dollars. That was the deal. Now China's saying, we don't want to pay for it in dollars anymore. We want to pay for it with our currency, the yuan. So, yes, Russia, we'll buy your oil from you, but we're going to pay you in yuan. But I'll tell you what you'll do. You could turn it into gold, because China's buying up the gold as well as the Russians, physical gold. They're telling the Venezuelans the same thing, because the United States is putting sanctions on Russia and Venezuela, harder for them to get dollars. So they're selling it in their own currency. They're selling it and getting paid in yuan. Now, China's also saying that to Saudi Arabia. Yeah, we'll buy your oil, but we don't want to pay for it in dollars. This is the beginning of the end of the petrodollar. It's not going to happen tomorrow, because when you look at the reserve currencies around the world, the United States is still the number one at about 40% of all the currency exchanges. It's in dollars. China's only about 2% right now. But it's the beginning of the end. And the end will happen when the petrodollar crashes. You'll be going to Walmart with wheelbarrows full of money like they did with the Weimar Republic back before World War II. Because you just saw what happened with the tax plan by Trump. That, by the way, again, another liar that lied his way into office. As early as September 12th, he said publicly that this tax plan would not help the rich. And that's all it's done. It's given the average person in the middle class the grand total of $900 a year in tax breaks. And, of course, as everybody knows, it's a homeowner in New York, and we all pay these ridiculously high school taxes and property taxes. We can no longer deduct those taxes. So now going back to the tax plan, all it's done is help the rich. But what it's going to do, it's going to temporarily boost the markets. But the long term, going back to, they just added $1.5 trillion to the deficit. It's already at $20 trillion. So they're going to keep pumping this thing up for as long as they can. And just another note on Iran, the woman running the UN, Nikki Haley, is, you want to talk about somebody sick and out of their mind, and don't call me misogynist for calling a woman sick. I call them all sick, race, creed, color, gender, save it for somebody else. I don't care what religion you are. Great and good and bad comes in all of them. We have someone that is a lying sociopath that makes statements to the UN without any basis and without any foundation, but keeps selling war. And that's what they're doing. We're not concerned, by the way, about war with North Korea, because if the United States invades North Korea, say goodbye to South Korea, say goodbye to Japan. Because the reason why the North Koreans are holding on to nuclear weapons, they made it very clear, they saw what the United States did to Gaddafi and Hussein. And the North Koreans have been wanting peace talks, and the United States refuses it. If North Korea, Russia, were on the east coast of the United States near Newport News, if the Chinese were down in the Gulf of Mexico and the Iranians were off the coast of San Diego doing massive military maneuvers all year long, do you think the United States would be a little bit upset and tight about it? And that's what the United States is doing to North Korea, trying to provoke them.
Where do you see Wall Street being over the next year?
It's going to, again, we see Wall Street going up only because of the cheap money coming in. If they raise interest rates too much and the cheap money stops, Wall Street goes down. End of story. Because, Gary, you're looking at price-earning ratios in stocks, according to the Shiller Index, that are at pre-1929. And dot-com bubble 2000 level busts. So the only way the markets keep going at these high valuations is the availability of cheap money. And again, they're allowing the multinationals to bring the Apples and the Googles and all the others to bring back the trillions they have stored overseas. They'll use that in stock buybacks to drive up the value of their current of their stocks. At some time, that'll bust. Everybody knows it. And to us, the when is going to happen as a black swan event, probably, such as a war. And by the way, when that happens, gold prices, and I've been saying this for 4 years, gold has to break over $1,400 an ounce and steadily at $1,450, $1,480 before it does a Bitcoin bounce. And I'm mentioning this because when this thing crashes, people are also going to go into their cryptocurrencies. The cryptocurrency trend is new. There's going to be shakeouts of it, but we don't see this dying, even though countries are trying to stop it, because it's making banking needless, and they're the ones, they're printing up all this phony fiat currency. At least you have a cap on a number of cryptocurrencies. So there's going to be a big shakeout. We're in the cryptocurrency market, as we see it, just prior to the dot-com bubble burst. But after the burst, the internet revolution continued, and we see this continuing too.
Okay, I appreciate all this input. My final question, if you have a short answer on this, is that the entire major media in America continues to parrot the idea that we only have a 4.2% unemployment rate when they have 102 million Americans who once worked, could work, and some are working part-time. And they're saying, no, our economy's booming, and I'm seeing an awful lot of people who are not and a part of that boom. Why don't they tell us the truth about the real unemployment level?
Because they lie about everything. Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction and ties to Al-Qaeda. Read my lips, no new taxes. I didn't have sex with that woman, Monica Lewinsky. What adult would believe anything that they say, just like the inflation index? Everybody that lives know how expensive everything gets. You were talking about going into a place up in Uptown, you know, how expensive everything is. The reason why the economy's going in these hot cities in America is because of outside people from around the world with money, whether it's Miami, New York, Los Angeles, San Francisco, and a small population within the city that has dough. And when you look at the real numbers, three people in the United States, Warren Buffett, Jeff Bezos of Amazon, and Bill Gates, have more money than half the United States population combined. So you talked about the unemployment rate, but as you also mentioned that the people that are not working is at a level now, is back to 1960s levels, as well as home ownership, by the way. People can't afford to own homes. So America's become a neo-feudal society. We have the economic elite and the political nobility, and the rest of us are just workers in Slavelandia. And you just saw what happened. Again, Bezos, they're giving him $4 billion to build a slave camp called an Amazon shipping plant that we have to pay for in tax breaks. And Foxconn, the Taiwanese company that's coming into Wisconsin, that they're giving almost $5 billion worth of tax breaks and getting rid of environmental regulations. It's a takeover. It's called fascism, a merger of state and corporate powers.
Joe, as always, thank you for the uplifting information. Gerald, I want you having more fiber tomorrow to start the new year with a smile.
I'm smiling all the time. Take care, man.
Take care. Gerald Salante, we're ending our program today, 2017, and I will be here on New Year's Day on Monday for my projections for the new year and a look back at the last one, all with the idea of how can we live longer, better, happier lives and communicate and work together. Thank you for listening today. See you then.